Good morning, Lifehouse Church. How's everybody doing this morning? All right, let's worship together. Lift them up together.
God above all the world in motion, God above all my hopes and fears, I don't care what the world throws at me now. Yeah, it's gonna be alright, yeah. Hear the sound. Hear the sound of generations making loud our freedom song. All in all, that the world would know your name. Yeah, it's gonna be alright, cause I know my God saved the day. And I know His word never fails. And I know my God made a way for me. Salvation is here.
That again, God above.
God above all the world in motion. God above all my hopes and fears. And I don't care what the world throws at me now. Yeah, it's gonna be alright, cause I know my God saved the day. And I know His word never fails. And I know I know my God saved the day, and I know His word never fails, and I know my God made a way for me. Hey, salvation is here.
Come on.
Salvation is here. Salvation is here, and it lives in me. Salvation is here. Salvation that died just to set me free. Salvation is here. Salvation is here, and it lives in me. Salvation is here. 'Cause you are alive. Salvation is here. Salvation is here, and He lives in me. Salvation is here, Jesus. You are alive, and You live in me. Sing it, church, 'cause I know my.
Come on. Praise the Lord this morning. Let's continue to worship. God, we thank You that You are here. Lord, that You are awesome, that You are everything. God, that You are able and above, far than what we can imagine and even think. We praise Your name, in Jesus' name.
Thank you. sing, God is able.
God is able, and He will never fail. He is Almighty God.
Believe that this morning.
Far than all we see, greater than all we ask. He has done great things. Lift it up.
Come on. Middletown, no. Be bold in Jesus' name.
Lift it up. He defeated the grave. Raised to life.
Seated. I just want to welcome you guys this morning. My name is Rob. I'm the worship pastor here at LifeHouse Church. If this is your very first time to LifeHouse, then you picked a great Sunday to come. Today is Promotion Sunday, so all of our kids are really hyper this morning. They're ready to go on up into their next age group, and so that may be the buzz this morning, but God is here. His Spirit is here, so that's probably the buzz, but we're glad you guys are here. If this is your very first time, ushers are coming forward. They have a card for you. If you wouldn't mind filling that card out and dropping it in the offering basket, it's going to go by about 10 or 15 minutes from now, so you got plenty of time to fill that out. We just want to know who is here. If you have any questions about the church, maybe you have a prayer request, man, one of our pastors will get a hold of you this week about that. We want to make sure that you are touched this week, and most importantly, that you had a good experience this morning. So we're glad you're here. On your way out after church, be sure to visit our Connect table. We have a free gift for you and your family. So if you go out those doors here from the auditorium, look to your left, you'll see a big sign that says Connect. That's for you guys. Come over, get your gift. Again, we'll hope you feel welcome this morning. If you're a first-time guest and I'm talking to you, would you mind raising your hand, getting one of these cards? That's all we're going to ask you this morning. Church, let's welcome these guys this morning. Thanks for coming.
Morning, church. My name is Malcolm Van Adden. I'm a partner here at LifeHouse, and this is the time of our service where we worship God through communion, or as many know it, the Lord's table, or communion, or time to unmask the betrayer. I've got 9 verses. If you want to grab Matthew 26, 9 verses that the Lord has not released me from this morning in my quiet time. I asked him, I said, Lord, do you want me to speak about when you were reclining at the table and the betrayer was unmasked? Answer was yes. So I'm going to grab it. I'm going to go through it here with you as we set this table. When he, Jesus, was reclining at the table with the 12 and they were eating, he said, truly I say to you, one of you will betray me. And they were very sorrowful and began to say to him, and one another, one after another, is it I, Lord? Grab that word right there, Lord. Grab that word, Lord. Is it I, Lord? He, Jesus, answered, he who dipped his hand in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man goes as is written of him. But woe to that man whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man not to have been born. Judas, who would betray him, answered, is it I, Rabbi? Grab that word, Rabbi. He, Jesus, said to him, you have said so. You notice the other disciples called him Lord? They were his Lord. But Judas said, Rabbi, teacher. Sitting at that table, set for sinners. This table is for sinners. But at that table, there were sinners who called Jesus Lord. He had been their Lord, their God. And there was a sinner who called Jesus teacher. He had simply been just a teacher to him. So if Jesus is teacher in your life, we humbly ask that you abstain from this portion of our service. And there'll be a time later that you'll be able to make Jesus your Lord. But right now, this table is set for the believer, those who have put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. It's a wonderful time, but a sorrowful time, a time of rejoicing. That's why as I stand here, most of the time I'm silly in my jokes and stuff like that, but this is a time for reverence. Approach this table with reverence, church. Now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread. After blessing it, he broke it and he gave it to the disciples and he said, take, eat, this is my body. The body, a paschal lamb. Jesus is present at this table and he's holding a piece of bread. He is the lamb. He is the bread. This symbol of who he is present with his physical body, but it is the bread. So it can't be just taken out of the scripture that this bread is his body, but it's a great representation of who he is. Now, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said to them, drink it all of you, for this is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. This blood, this cup, this cup of the blessing, as it's called, the third cup in the Passover, was the cup of blessing. This is your portion, church. This is your portion, believer. The cup of the blessing. We take the bread and we dip it in the cup. It's juice at LifeHouse. We take that bread and we dip it in the cup of the blessing and we take it. And we'll have ushers coming forward soon. And they'll be positioned on my right, your left, and over here, and two in the back. And you'll try to stay to the right. But right now, there's a time for reverence where we repent of our sin. That this blood sacrifice is totally and completely sufficient to cover our sins. That Jesus has made a way, like we sung. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. That's his promise. So right now, as we bow our heads in reverence, if you need to kneel, if you need to fall on your face right now, bow your heads with me. Let's repent, church, as the ushers are coming forward and getting into position. We're searching our hearts. Many of us all knew this was coming. We knew it was Communion Sunday, and we were preparing, just like Jesus prepared for the Passover service with his disciple, changing from the Passover to the Lord's table, doing away with the old Passover and fulfilling it in him. So right now, join that table. Repent. Pour out. Whatever is hindering you, whatever is stopping you, pour it out. Whatever needs to be repented of, whatever sin is in your life and is a present, put it at the feet of Jesus right now. Father, we pour out our sins. Father, we come before you as heirs in your name, followers of your way. We thank you for your table. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for what you've done and what you continue to do in our church and our lives. We offer our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to you right now in the name of Jesus. We love you, Lord. We pour out our sins, and we know that when we are far away, that you have not moved at all. There is no variation or shadow due to change in your name. I ask that you bless this service, that you bless these elements in which you bring before us, representation of your body and blood. Church, when you're ready, when you've searched your heart and you're ready to approach the Lord's table, do so with great reverence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, yes. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born. The precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior, isn't he worthy? As you wait for the crown, tell the world of the treasure you found.
Father, we thank you. God, we ask for that boldness to tell others of what we know. Lord, we know the truth. Lord, there are so many around us who do not know the truth, who are perishing. Lord, open our eyes to see that they are perishing before us. Lord, we have to step up. We have to tell them. But we pray as we worship you through giving and now through remembrance and through giving and singing, Lord, would you be blessed with what goes on. May you be the center of our attention today. We praise you. You can be seated.
Good morning, Lifehouse Church. My name is Kevin Hankey, and my wife, Wendy, and my three teens, Jenna, Jared, and Justin, are partners here at Lifehouse Church. Now is the time of our service where we worship through giving. You can participate in the offering several ways, as listed behind me on the screen. Online, through the LifeHouse app, there's a kiosk in the hallway, text to give, which is my preference, or more traditionally as the baskets are passed in the moment. Our family first walked through the doors of LifeHouse three years ago last Sunday. We have been so encouraged in how God is working through this church here in Middletown, and how this town and surrounding region is being impacted by the gospel. One thing that strikes me about Lifehouse is the generosity is displayed and how God is pouring out his blessing on this church. As we follow him and proclaim him, he continues to pour out his blessing. Rob sent me a text last month asking if I'd be willing to share during this time. Like many of us who are presented the opportunity to speak in front of hundreds of people, I was super excited. Well, actually it's not entirely true. Let me confess. This introvert is actually more excited when Rob texts me asking if I could fix another one of his broken iPhones. But I know that even though this is not one of my gifts, God continually upholds me. and provides me strength to follow him. So I agreed to serve and to share. Rob followed up in the email, asked me if I'd focus on the subject of generous giving results in bountiful blessing. Along with the email attached a short devotional. As I reflected earlier this week on what specifically I was going to say, I reread the devotional and thought how timely this message was after Pastor Mark shared last week about God's blessing. Our Lord said in Luke 6:38, "Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be poured into your lap. For with measure you use, it will be measured back to you." This is not an isolated concept in the New Testament. In 2 Corinthians 9:6 through 8, the Apostle Paul states, "The point is, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so you have having all sufficiency in all things at all times may abound in every good work." If you give to God, the word says that God will give to you. If you give bountifully to him, he will give bountifully to you. That said, let me be clear. I think the prosperity theology so popular today is heresy. It perverts the gospel, it misrepresents God, it misleads those who are holding fast to this teaching. I do not believe that if you give a lot to God, he will make you financially rich here on earth. But I do believe that passages like these indicate that earthly blessings of an unspecified nature will be given to those who are faithful stewards of God's money. The end of verse 8 talks about having all sufficiency in all things, at all times you may abound in every good work. That's clearly speaking of earthly blessings. But God never says that if you faithfully give, he'll give you a lot of money or some specific earthly blessing. He does say that he'll bless you in this life if you trust him enough to be generous in your giving to him. Beware, though, there's three enemies of generous giving. The first is the world wants your money. That's pretty plain through advertising we see all around us. Secondly, Christians possess the same sinful desire as everyone else. The Bible calls this desires of the flesh, to spend money selfishly. Third, the devil tempts us and wastes money because he is our enemy and the enemy of God's kingdom, and he wants to ruin our lives and the work of God. But if God really loves us, and he demonstrated the depth of his love on the cross, as we sung about this morning, then we must believe that he will tell us how to use the resources he entrusted us in ways that will benefit us and bring us more joy than if we were trying to do it on our own, with our own agenda. Most of God's blessings for our giving, however, will not come in this life. It takes faith to believe that giving money here on earth lays up treasure in heaven. It takes faith to believe that Jesus rightly said is more blessed than is to give than to receive. But if these passages are true, and I know they are, we can believe that at a definite time in a real place, God is going to reward us bountifully for what we have given generously and cheerfully. Regardless of how you interpret this message, regardless of how much God rewards you here for giving or how much he rewards you in heaven, the bottom line is clear. God will bless you bountifully if you give generously. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for your word and for your faithfulness. We praise, reflect on your truth that you will give us the faith and the realization that generosity is something you want for us, not from us. As the psalmist proclaims, you own a cattle on 1,000 hills. You own it all. Help us grasp this truth, that generous giving results in bountiful blessing. Thank you for your blessing as we continue to trust you more and more each day and walk in obedience to you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Good morning. I want to invite you at this time to turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 5. As we'll continue our congregational journey verse by verse through the first 11 chapters of the first book of the Bible. In this passage, in Genesis chapter 5, we'll find a genealogy recorded, a family record of 10 generations that from the first man, Adam, all the way to his great, however many greats, grandchildren, Noah and his sons. A genealogy that by the grace of God continued and that will eventually lead to many generations later, Jesus, as recorded in the Gospel of Luke. The genealogy that's recorded here in Genesis chapter 5 is in contrast to the one that was recorded in Genesis chapter 4. If you remember from last week, the line, the generations, the line of Cain, who murdered his brother Abel. It's a tragic story, a horrible story. And if you remember, it was told specifically of Cain that he went away from the presence of the Lord. In other words, Cain, picture it in your mind. I mean, it's sobering to think about the reality of what took place. Cain turned his back, walked away from God, from his creator. And in doing so, he walked away from open arms. In doing so, he walked away from love. Think about what he walked away from. And in doing so, we're told that he settled literally in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Furthermore, Cain, in walking away from God, led his family astray. He took his wife, his children, grandchildren with him and settled in the land of Nod. His legacy was one of sin, one of separation from a holy God who loved him and his family, one of settling not only in the land of Nod, but for infinitely less than what was available, not only to him, but to his family as well. Through God, he walked away from it all, never to return. But in contrast to that family, to that legacy, we see in Genesis chapter 5 a whole different legacy, that of the legacy of Seth, Cain's brother, a son of Adam. And we're informed in Genesis chapter 5 that this legacy is one of faith. As it was through Seth's family, as we're told leading into chapter 5, that it was through this people, through this group, through this family line that men, that people began to call upon the name of the Lord, acknowledge the Lord, to worship him for who he was, and he is worthy of worship. Cain, Genesis chapter 4, walked away from God, but we are told about a man in Genesis chapter 5 named Enoch who walked with God. That's his testimony, and that's what I want to focus on this morning. Enoch walked with God. Think about what that means, what that entails, and I want to ask you to consider before we go any further, your life and your walk. Do you walk with God? Do you walk with God? And if not, I hope you will be encouraged this morning to know that you can. Do you walk with God? If not, for whatever reason, and listen, there are a lot of reasons that would keep you, a lot of obstacles, a lot of things that would keep you from walking with God, whatever the reason may be. If you do not walk with God, if you are not walking with God, it's my prayer this morning that you will. If you came in that way this morning, my prayer is that you will leave differently, that you will walk with God. We're told in Scripture that he is the friend that sticks closer than a brother. He never walks away from us, but we walk away from him. Do you walk with God? Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me does not have to walk in darkness. Do you walk in darkness? Jesus said you don't have to because you have the light that leads to life. Jesus says in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Whoever follows me, that is, does what I tells him to, or excuse me, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father except through me. He is the way. He didn't say, I am a way to the Father. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And what he's saying there is that through him and through him alone, there is no other way, nothing that you can do, nothing that you can say, only because of who I am and what I've done. Through me, you can come unto the Father. But guess what? You can do more than that. You can not only and just come unto the Father. You can stand before a holy, righteous God. And guess what? Through him, you can walk with a holy, righteous God. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, no matter who you are, through Jesus, the Son, the way, you can come unto, stand before, and walk with a holy, righteous God. Enoch walked with God, and we'll also see this morning that he was well-pleasing to God, and we'll see this morning that he was a witness for God. Let's pray as we prepare to read Genesis chapter 5. Father God, we look to you, we ask you, we call upon your name just like they did way back in Genesis chapter 4, verse 26. Seth and Enoch, who we're going to look in more detail at this morning, they called upon your name and they walked with you. And so we call upon you to do what only you can do. We rest in your promises of Scripture and that when it is proclaimed, it will not return void. God, your will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let's read together, starting in verse 1 of Genesis chapter 5. We're told this is the book of the generations of Adam. And then we're told when God created man, and there's kind of a reminder here in this first part of Genesis chapter 5, reminding of us of all those foundational truths that have already been laid for us in the beginning of Genesis in these first four chapters. Understand and know, remember as we go into this genealogy that God created man. He's the one that started it all. God created man, and he made him in the likeness of God. If you remember, in his own image, in his own likeness, he created him, unique and special above the rest of his creation. Man is the crown of his creation. And in verse 2, it says, male and female, he created them. So there's distinction, there's specificity, there's intentionality communicated in this passage. Divine design. This is not random. This is not arbitrary, haphazard, or ambiguous. God created them, male and female, and he blessed them, his creation. And he named them man when they were created. He, with pride and joy, named them. And that's connotating there, if you remember, affection. And not only affection and love, but also authority. He named them. Verse 3, and when Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness after his image and named him Seth. The days of Adam after he fathered Seth were 800 years, and he had other sons and daughters. So there we get the answer to all the questions that have been coming in. Who did Cain marry? And who did Abel marry? And who did Seth marry that we're going to talk about today? Adam and Eve had other sons and daughters. And look, I know it's not pretty, but it is what it was. And that's how it was back then, where there weren't a lot of options. They married their brothers and sisters. Adam had other sons and daughters. So to answer that question, thus all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and then he died. And you'll see another answer to a question that's been asked is these people, men, these lines that we see, they lived much longer than we live today, hundreds and hundreds of years as opposed to less than 100 years as we do today. And my understanding of that is that sin had not yet pervaded the world that we live in to the degree that it has now. And so they lived longer then. Death did not have the hold that it does today. And so they lived much longer back in these times, hundreds and hundreds of years. Verse 6 says that when Seth had lived 105 years, he fathered Enosh. Seth lived after he fathered Enosh 807 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. When Enosh had lived 90 years, he fathered Kenan. Enosh lived after he fathered Kenan 815 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and then he died. And when Kenan had lived 70 years, he fathered Mahalalel. And Kenan had lived after he fathered Mahalalel 840 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. When Mahalalel had lived 65 years, he fathered Jared. And Mahalalel lived after he fathered Jared 830 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. When Jared had lived 162 years, he fathered Enoch. Jared lived after he fathered Enoch 800 years, and they had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he fathered Methuselah. Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah 300 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and then he was not, for God took him. Enoch walked with God. Think about that, what that means. Enoch walked with God. Do you walk with God? You can walk with God. Verse 25, when Methuselah had lived 187 years, he fathered Lamech. Methuselah lived after he fathered Lamech 782 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. When Lamech had lived 182 years, he fathered a son and called his name Noah, saying, out of the ground the Lord has cursed, this one shall bring us relief, salvation from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. Lamech lived, and after he fathered Noah 595 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. And after Noah was 500 years old, Noah fathered Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Last week, Tammy, my wife, and I celebrated 20 years of marriage. Amen. Not to get sappy or anything like that, but I'm about to get sappy. I'm just giving you a heads up. But I literally remember the very first time that I laid eyes on her. I had driven to Virginia to pick my brothers up for Thanksgiving break from college. I had the whole week off. They just had Wednesday through the weekend off. They were attending Liberty. And as they were finishing up their exams, there was a convocation service that day. And I went with them, and there was a girl singing that day, just like she was this morning. And boy, did she make an impression on me. So much so that I can picture to this very day, more than 20 years, exactly what she was wearing, the outfit she was wearing. She was wearing a navy floral pleated skirt, cream tights, brown shoes, a silky shiny shirt, and a big over baggy sweater. An outfit, most of which that she purchased at Goodwill. But you look like a million bucks to me. My brothers both knew her, and I immediately expressed the question, who is that girl? Expressed my interest in her to them at that time. Ultimately, I felt led to go to Liberty University. Listen, honestly, to transfer. And it was not because of Tammy, but I'm telling you, I was excited about the opportunity after God led me to Liberty. And I made sure to tell my brothers, first thing on the agenda is for you to introduce me to that girl that sang. My brother Ben did eventually introduce us, and although it had all been orchestrated, I'm telling you, it's kind of hard to do that, but they orchestrated it all, made sure she would be at the cafeteria when I was at the cafeteria, and she knew that I had asked about her, and I knew that she was interested in meeting me as well, but when the moment came in the cafeteria, I don't know if you remember, Tammy, I remember my brother specifically saying, Mark, you know Tammy, right? Well, both of us, Tammy and I, acted as though we had no clue who the other one was. Got to keep it cool, right? I mean, it's just the way it works. You look familiar. Were you wearing a navy pleated skirt with flowers and cream tights and brown shoes and a baggy sweater? I think you look familiar. Obviously, thankfully, that led to a relationship and a marriage. And by the grace of God, we, Tammy and I, have been walking together as husband and wife for 20 years, living life together. For 20 years, and mind you, as you might imagine, it was not, it has not been, and it is not easy. We've been through some pretty devastating things together. But we've had some amazing experiences together. We've shed tears. We've been desperate, desperate for God. But through it all, we're grateful, and I know, without a shadow of a doubt, before God, I tell you, I would not trade 1 minute of what we've been through, the hard times, the desperate times, because God has been faithful. Amen. Prior to me meeting Tammy, just a few months before me meeting Tammy, I called upon the name of the Lord Jesus for salvation. I was a new believer. And I had begun at that time to walk with God, follow Jesus. And so when I met Tammy, who was walking with God herself, we were headed in the same direction. And I believe it was God who orchestrated and ordained this meeting and led us to one another. And on our journey together, as I look back, there were times when we got off track. I'm not proud of those times. She or me or we. There were times when we fell. I stumbled in sin. And there were times, and I'm not proud of it, when I turned my back on God and chose to go my own way. And I went astray. As the old hymn says, and I think about it every time we sing, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. But our God graciously, and I'm here to testify through repentance and through faith, was always ready and willing to receive us back. The saying is true. He is the friend that sticks closer than a brother, and he will never, no, never, ever leave us or forsake us. We walk away from him. We turn our back on him, but he was always there waiting and ready to receive us and walk with us once again. Our journey, our walk, my walk with God has not been easy, but it has been blessed, and I'm so thankful. And what I have found on this journey, you can find, and what I have tasted in the Lord, you can taste. You can walk with God if you're not walking with God. Perhaps at some point in your life you can relate. You got off track somehow. You don't even know where it began and when it began. But right now you can hear his voice calling you, come on home. I'm ready. My arms are open to you. Go home. Perhaps you stumbled at some point in your life. You fell and you're discouraged. And maybe it's guilt. Maybe it's shame. Maybe it's fear. For whatever reason, you're not walking with God. And my challenge, my charge, my prayer to you is that you will rise up in Jesus Christ, that you will wake up and continue on the journey that he has set before you. He has a plan for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Don't miss out on those plans. Interestingly, it's clear in this passage that Enoch did not, or we can assume, or I assume, that Enoch did not always walk with God. We're told not necessarily why. We're told that he had a son, and after he had that son, that's when he began to walk with the Lord, after those 90 years or whatever it was before he had his son. I know that's my testimony. There was a time when I was clearly not walking with God. The Spirit of God did not live in my heart. But then when I called upon the name of the Lord and the Spirit was born in me, I began a journey, a relationship with him. I walked with him. And that's our burden here at Lifehouse Church. I believe so many believers, people who place their faith and trust in Jesus, are hanging out at the start line, and we're not meant to hang out at the start line. We're meant to go on a journey. We're to begin a relationship with Jesus. We're to grow in him and to learn from him. So many people miss out. Salvation is not a destination. It's the beginning, the start of a relationship and journey with God, a walk with God. From that point, are you walking with God? Enoch walked with God. Genesis 5:21 says that he had lived 65 years. He fathered Methuselah, and then he walked with God after he fathered Methuselah for 300 years. Do you walk with God? Enoch did. Think about what that means, what that entails to walk with God. How do you live your life? Is it ambiguous? Those first 65 years of Enoch's life, we don't know if he walked with God or not. Is that what someone say about your life? Not really sure if he walks with God or not. He calls himself a Christian. She says she believes in the Lord Jesus. She goes to church on Sunday, but something's not adding up as I watch them live out their life Monday through Saturday, or Sunday afternoon through Saturday. Enoch walked with God. Everybody knew it. What's that mean, to walk with God? Micah tells us in 6:8 of his book, he says to the people of God, he has told you, God has told you, God who loves you has made it clear what is good for you. And listen, God knows better than you. God has told you it's clear what the Lord requires of you, what's best for you, simply to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Don't walk away from him. Don't turn your back on him. Don't settle in the land of Nod. Do you? Have you accepted the invitation before you this morning to walk with God, or are you rejecting? Again, open arms, that opportunity to walk with Almighty, Holy God, Jehovah, Jireh, the God who provides Yahweh. What's it mean to walk with God? The reality is we could be all here all morning and night talking about just that, but I want to start out with talking about it means to walk humbly. Realizing that he calls the shots, that he's the authority, he's in charge. God doesn't join us on our journey, we join him. Where he's at work, he's not like so many people believe, our genie in the bottle. He is our Savior, he is our King, and he is our Lord. Remember what Jesus clearly said, humble Jesus who was willing to die for us. He said, understand, know this, all authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me. Believer, child of God, do you live your life in that regard, regarding that reality, that truth, that all authority in heaven and on earth have been given to Jesus, the one whom you placed your faith and trust in? And not only are you to live in light of that, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. You need to understand and revere him and who he is, but understand we are to be encouraged as we obey him, the authority that he's with us every step of the way. He sees us where we go, and he leads us, and he guides us. Walking with God means walking humbly. It means walking in obedience to his word. We have his word. It's available to us. Jesus says, if you love me, and listen, to know Jesus is to love Jesus, to understand who he is and what he's done, and the love that he shed and he poured out for you, you love him back. He who's forgiven much loves much. And Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey me. That is my word. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says that we are to trust in the Lord with all our heart and lean not on our own understanding, but in all our ways and everything we do, we are to acknowledge him. And he will, if we do that, make our paths straight. He will show us where to go and what to do. He will lead us. He will walk with us. To walk with the Lord means to walk in love. Listen, he loves us. To know him is to love him, and we're to love the things that he loves, the people that he loves. It means to walk in dependence. That's a hard thing for us to understand, you know, especially in our culture. We don't need God, right? We're so smart. We've got education. We've got resources. We don't need God. I remember when we planted the church 5.5 years ago. And I remember telling people in the very beginning, especially that first year, almost apologetically telling every first-time guest, look, understand that we are a work in progress. And I would say that every time, thinking that there would be a day, praying for the day, that we would not be a work in progress, that we would figure everything out, and that we would be so organized. Tammy and I are both type A, and that was a struggle in the beginning years of our marriage. And it's a struggle as we walk with God, because guess what? God wants us to walk in dependence upon him, and we are always and continually to be a work in progress. What I'm realizing now, 5.5 years in, by the grace of God, we are still a work in progress, and by the grace of God, we will be, should he allow us to continue, a work in progress 10, 20, 30 years from now. But guess what? He who began a good work will be faithful to complete it. We should always be a work in progress. And when you walk with God, you need to walk in dependence upon him. Paul saw that, his thorn in the flesh, if you remember that. He said, listen, I understand and know that this thorn in the flesh is there for a reason. It's to keep me humble. It means that I need in my weakness to rest in the power of God. And guess what? I boast in that power, because his power, my experience, Paul said, has been made perfect in my weakness. Paul was dependent on God every step of the way on his journey as he served Jesus. That never changed. We never figure it out. We never arrive spiritually. We are to be a work in progress all the days of our life as we walk with God. And guess what? God, who loves you, may lead you through dark times. He leads me through the valley of the shadow of death. But guess what? I will fear no evil. Why? Because you're with me every step of the way. The men's Bible study, Paul said, and listen, if you are not a part of the men's Bible study that meets the second and the fourth, the women meet the first and the third, you're missing out. I'm telling you, it's one of my favorite things that I personally do at Lifehouse Church. And listen, I don't lead it. I'm just a part of it. It's a time when men get together and iron sharpens iron, and we just open the word at Chick-fil-A. And I'm telling you, yesterday I wanted to shout. I wanted to do backflips about what we talked about and what was said. There, the Apostle Paul, and mind you, his testimony is he left everything to follow Jesus Christ. He had everything, and he left it all behind. And he suffered as he followed Jesus Christ. And in Philippians chapter 1, he acknowledges that he is in prison for the gospel, and he's writing this church, this group of people, his brothers and sisters in Christ who are understandably worried about him, who probably don't understand, who are questioning God, who are angry with God and thinking, why is Paul in prison? God, he loves you. He left everything to follow you. He's serving you. Why is he in prison? Why are things so difficult? Don't you see him? Don't you care about him? Don't you love him? You know what Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, Paul who walked with God? He said, I want you to know, my brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me, all the suffering, the fact that I'm here in prison, has really served to advance the gospel. And I can hear the joy. Listen, he says a lot of other things. There is joy expressed in that passage. He's saying, you're not going to believe this. In other words, kind of what Satan meant for evil, God has meant for good. Satan thought he was going to take me out and put me in prison. But guess what? I'm right where I need to be, doing what God has called me to do. I'm walking. He's with me every step of the way. And guess what? He's given me peace. He's given me joy. He's giving me strength. And I am right where I need to be. And guess what? The whole Imperial Guard in this prison cell, everyone who's guarding me, guess who they're hearing about? Jesus. The gospel. Walking in dependence. Interestingly, walking with God may be running with God. Paul ran. I love the passage that talks about how he ran the race, and we are to run the race of life. And he says, so that you can run with God, so you don't just have to walk with God. You can run. He says, if you want to do that, you need to cast aside every sin that's holding you back. Do you need to do that this morning, believer? What's holding you back from running after God? Are there things that you're bearing, sins that you're carrying around that you don't need to carry around? Is there a ball and chain that you're dragging around when you could be walking with Jesus and running after him? Walking with God may mean waiting on God. That's hard, isn't it? I don't like to wait. But there are times when in my journey walking with God, he wants me to be still and just know that he is God and to hear from him, experience him. I love the examples we have in Scripture, and they encourage me as I walk with him. Do you walk with God? Walking with God does not mean comfort. It does not mean safety. Understand and know that. Jesus told his disciples, and you hear me say this all the time, he warned them. He said, you will experience tribulation. If you're going to do what I've told you to do, share the gospel. If you're going to spread the gospel and build the kingdom, people are going to hate you. They're going to persecute you. You will experience tribulation, and understand and know that he didn't give them that warning to hinder them or to maybe discourage them from walking with him. No, he just wanted them to have a heads up so that they would know they need him and to be aware. Walking with God means peace and joy regardless of your circumstances, in spite of your situation, as overwhelming, as devastating as they may be. And I'm not here to make light of any situations. I'm telling you, represented in this room, I'm overwhelmed myself thinking, how is this person even continuing on? Walking with God means walking by faith, trusting him, and receiving the peace that he gives us and the joy that he gives us regardless of our situation. Enoch walked with God, and we are told he was not, for God took him. And what that means is explained in Hebrews chapter 11. He walked by faith, and as such, he pleased by God. He trusted God. God just took him home to be with him. He pleased God that much. He is one who walked with God, did not experience death, and his testimony is a testimony for us. Paul even mocked death, this thing that we're all afraid of. He said, death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? It doesn't have a hold on me. I'm not afraid. He even said in Philippians, listen, if I die, guess what? I'm going to Jesus. And he says, to be with Jesus is far better. I'd love to go with Jesus. Death, where is your sting? Enoch, by faith, was walking with God before men, and then all of a sudden, he just wasn't there. God took him. He did not experience death. In the same way, I took Tammy to be my lawfully wedded wife, and she took me to be her husband. She allowed me to take her, and I allowed her to take me. She pleased me, and so I took her, and I kept her. Enoch walked with God, and second, Enoch was well-pleasing to God by faith, Hebrews 11 says, verse 5 and 6. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. Now, before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God, and we're told the reason he pleased God is because, verse 6, by his faith. And we're told in verse 6, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Do you please God? Do you have faith? Do you live your life in such a way that expresses, God, I love you. God, I trust you. Enoch was well-pleasing to God, first and foremost, because he walked by faith. He lived his life expressing his faith. There's a lot of overlap with all these other things, obedience and humility and love, but it all boils down to faith. And as such, Enoch was well-pleasing to God. Do you believe, believer, what you claim to believe? What Scripture tells us in the promises of God? Do you believe your life will play out? If you do, that will play out in how you live your life. It will be reflected in your life. Do you walk with God? As silly as it may sound, the song "Walk Like an Egyptian" kept coming to my mind this week. That's what our world wants us to do. The Egyptians worshipped other gods, placed their faith and trust in other things. Empty cisterns that held no water, and they did not honor or acknowledge God. Listen, don't walk like an Egyptian. Walk like a Christian. Live out your faith sincerely and genuinely, like you really believe what you claim to believe. How in your life right now Does your life express faith? How do you express, Lord, I trust you, your word, who you are, what you've done? It's one thing to obey God when it's easy. It's one thing to obey God and be about God when everything's good, or to follow God when everything's going well on Sundays at church or youth camp week. I'm telling you, there's a lot of fired up teenagers about Jesus youth camp week. Oh, that God, that fire, that passion would continue throughout the year. What about following God and expressing faith when it's not easy? How about those times, those days? What about Monday through Saturday? Do you obey God like the widow who put in those last two mites that she had to live on? Do you trust God like Paul did even when he was in prison, and so much so he rejoiced? Do you follow Jesus even when it's not popular to follow Jesus and to walk with God at work, at school, at home, during the week? Do you think my wife Tammy would be pleased if I took my wedding ring off because I didn't want people to know that I was married? Do you think it would make my wife happy if she knew that I was ashamed of her? And listen, I am in no way, shape, or form ashamed of her, but would that bring her joy? Absolutely not. And it brings not God joy to know if any of his children are ashamed of him. In fact, Jesus says in Luke 9:26, if anyone, whoever is ashamed of me, of him, of that person will I be ashamed of when I come in glory. Do you please God? Do you trust God in spite of your diagnosis? Do you trust God regardless of your financial position? Do you trust God in the midst of your suffering? Even when you don't know what lies ahead? Walking with God means walking by faith. Tammy and I often joke, at some point we read in a book somewhere about how God doesn't give us a roadmap. We want roadmaps. Again, we're type A. We want to know where the bathroom stops are and when we're getting off and when we're going to the rest area and so on and so forth. God doesn't work that way. What this book illustrated was that God gives us a compass because he wants us to look to him for direction, not just in the beginning of our journey, but each and every step of our journey. And he wants to show us the next move. And guess what? He may take you in one direction and you may set out for one direction, but God may tell you to take a left turn. The T's will not be crossed, the I's will not be dotted. It means walking with God means sacrifice, and it may mean suffering. But what you need to know and see is that Enoch did not just walk with God, but you also need to see that God, because he took him, loved the way he walked. And as a child of God saved by grace through faith in Jesus, it should matter to us. We want to please God. We want God to love the way we walk. Does God love the way you walk? Jesus says in John 4, the Lord, Father, God is seeking those who will worship him in spirit and in truth, who will walk in a way of worship. Is your life a fragrant aroma to God like Jesus was when he went to the cross? It says specifically in Ephesians 5:2 that Christ loved us, he gave himself up for us, and him doing that, that action, what he did, that obedience to his Father God's plan was a fragrant aroma. It was a pleasing thing to God that Jesus did that. Does your life please God? On the flip side, God told his people through the prophet Isaiah in chapter 1 of that book, even though they were worshiping God, doing all the right things, oh, they gathered to worship just like they were supposed to do. They were singing songs that everyone knew about God. They were giving offerings, but they were just going through the motions. They were not worshiping. They were not walking in a way that expressed, God, I love you. God, I trust you. What they were doing was obligatory to them, and what they did not please God. And guess what? God told them just that. He said, what you're doing, your quote-unquote worship, makes me sick. Remember, without faith, it's impossible to please God. They were going through the motions. They were worshiping. They were not expressing, God, I love you. God, I trust you. Even though they were doing what they were supposed to be doing, he said, if you're going to come to me that way, if you're going to worship me that way, don't come to me. Leave your offerings. Leave your vain words, your songs, and your empty worship at home. It's not what Enoch did. Nor should it be what we do. Enoch walked with God. Enoch was well-pleasing. He pleased the Lord. He walked by faith. And then finally we see that Enoch was a witness for God. How do we know that? Jude tells us in his letter in chapter 1, verse 14 and 15. And you need to understand the time of Enoch, it was a time where the world was corrupt. Sin had spread, and just a few chapters in Genesis, you'll see that God even says and expresses, I regret even making man. Sin had pervaded, and God, in judgment, in wrath against sin, wipes out sin and the men that the wages of sin is death, and Enoch was not okay with the sin that surrounded him, and so he proclaimed the truth. He told people, he warned people, he proclaimed, he did not whisper it in a corner. We're told that he prophesied. It says it was about these, referring to those who don't walk with God, that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied, saying, behold, this is the truth. The Lord comes with 10,000 of his holy ones to execute judgment on all and to convict all the ungodly of all their deeds and ungodliness. And it just goes on and on. I'm telling you, Enoch was not silent. As someone who walked with God and who loved God and who was well-pleasing to God, even when it had to have been difficult, even though he knew the people did not want to hear what he had to say, he could not stand by and watch people dishonor God and continue walking away from him and turning their back on a God who had open arms to them. And so he told them, this is what's going to happen if you continue walking down this road. Enoch was a witness for God, and guess what, brothers and sisters, so should we be. Even though our world and the enemy, Satan, wants us to shut up and stand by and just watch and observe, how can we? When we have been commissioned, we are to proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Proclaim means we are to shout it from the rooftops. We are to shine the light of Christ. That's what Enoch did in that dark time, in that dark day. Enoch walked with God. Everybody knew that Enoch walked with God. He was walking differently than the way other people around him are walking. Is that you? Do you walk with God? Do you please God expressing your faith? How do you express your faith? And finally, are you a witness for him? Do you share the truth? You hear me say all the time, the most loving thing that you could ever do as someone who knows the truth is share the truth. And the reality is, if you know the truth and you don't share it, in my opinion, that's the most unloving thing that you could ever do. Do it strategically, do it intentionally. There's times and ways that you can do it, but just to sit by and say nothing when you know that apart from Christ, the people around you are lost according to God's word. If they don't know Jesus, they are condemned to spend eternity in hell just like you were until someone told you the truth. You have an obligation. How can you stand by and not be a witness, not testify of this good news? Brothers and sisters, my prayer is that we would be emboldened, that we would be motivated, impressed to take a stand and to walk in a way that no one questions who we believe in and what we believe. And in such a way that people see what we believe and desire that for themselves. We know where we're headed. We know who we serve. We know who we love. Do you walk with God? Are you well-pleasing to God? And are you a witness for God? Consider that. Let's bow our heads and pray.